Hello friends, welcome to Learner's Planet. Friends, in the previous session we discussed the problems from CAT 2002. In this session we'll be taking problems from CAT 2003 based on quantitative aptitude. So let's begin the session, and I'm sure you are having your paper and pen with you. Just try to solve the problem on your own, then match your answer and solution with mine. Okay. Now friends, let's see this problem. Consider the sets Tn, n, n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus 3, n plus 4, where n is 1, 2, 3 up to 96. How many of these sets contain 6 or any integral multiple thereof? That means any one of the number that is 6, 12, 18 up to 96, right? That means multiple of 6 or 6, right? So how to proceed? For example, if I put n is equal to 1 from this, so I'll be getting 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. That means none of the number is multiple of 6, right? So for n is equal to 1, it's not valid. Now if I put n is equal to 2, so what I'll be getting, it's 2 3 4 5 6. That means I got one set that contains 6 or any multiple of that. That means in fact in this case it's just 6 only, right? So if I put n is equal to 2, I'll be getting the number 6, right? Similarly, if I put n is equal to 3, I'll be getting 6 over here. If I put n is equal to 4, I'll be getting 6 over here. If I put n is equal to 5, I'll be getting 6 over here. And if I put n is equal to 6, I'll be getting 6 over here, right? So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, these are the 5 values, when 5 sets when we'll be getting the set containing 6. Similarly, we can get 12 also. If I put n is equal to 8, then I'll be getting 12 over here. If I put n is equal to 9, I'll be getting 12 over here. Then if I put n is equal to 10, then 11 and then 12. So 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12, I'll be getting 5 sets containing number 12 and this 5 sets containing 6, right? So similarly, if we proceed further, till 96, then that means if I put n is equal to 92, I'll be getting 96. That is a multiple of 6, right? So we keep on getting like this. So precisely I'm getting 16 multiples of 6, like 6, 12, 18 up to 96, that is 16, 6 and 96. So 16 multiples of 6 I am getting, and each multiple is giving 5 sets, or that is present in 5 sets. In all 16 into 5, 80 sets will be there that will contain 6 or multiple of 6. Okay, I hope you are clear. Now in this question, let A, B, C, D, E, F be a regular hexagon. What is the ratio of area of triangle ACE to that of hexagon A, B, C, D, E, F? First of all, I just draw the diagram for you. So this is hexagon A, B, C, D, E, F. Right? Now we have to find out area of triangle ACE, that is A, C and E. Our friends, area of any hexagon is what? It's a addition of 6 equilateral triangles. Suppose the side of this hexagon is A, right? So these are 6 equilateral triangles, right? So area of one equilateral triangle is root 3 by 4 side square, right? So here it's A, so it's A square, and if there are 6 equilateral triangles, so it is 6 times root 3 by 4 side square. That is the area of hexagon. Okay. Now we have to find out the area of this triangle. In this case also, this is length A and this is length A. That is the length of sides of hexagon, right? Now I have to find out the length of this line. Okay. So I drop a perpendicular from here. Okay. Now this length is A. This complete angle is 120 degree. Since it is an hexagon, this angle will be half of that, that's 60 degree, right? Similarly, this angle will be of 30 degree, right? Now we can calculate the length of this portion. We take this triangle into consideration. Suppose this is P. So triangle PBC we consider and we try to find out the length of CP. Now we know this length and we have to find out this length. Suppose it is X, right? Now from trigonometry, cos theta gives the relationship between base and hypotenuse, right? So in this triangle, cos 30 degree, right? This triangle, cos 30 degree is what? Base over hypotenuse, that is X by A. And what is cos 30 degree? That is root 3 by 2. So X will be what? Root 3 A by 2, right? So this is half of the length. So the complete length will be into 2, sorry, root 3 A by 2. So it's 2 cancel. So this complete length will be root 3 A, right? Now since it is also an equilateral triangle, we can find out the area of this triangle. Just a moment. That is root 3 by 4 side square. So I just write root 3 by 4. And what is side? That is root 3 A. So square of that will be 3 A square, right? Now we can find out the ratio. This is hexagon and this is triangle, but we are asked about triangle versus hexagon. So we'll reverse it afterwards. So first of all, let's find out the ratio. It's cancelled. It's cancelled. So it's 2 by 1. So the reverse ratio will be 1 by 2. Okay. It's simple problem based on geometric knowledge and basic trigonometric knowledge. I hope you are clear. Now friends, let's discuss this question. This is going to be some interesting conceptual question. So before we proceed for this question, I'll just would like to discuss here the nature of common roots, right? Suppose I take a quadratic equation. This is a cubic equation, but here I would take a quadratic equation. Suppose I have a quadratic equation x minus a, x minus b is 0. And other quadratic equation as x minus a, x minus c is 0. Now you can very well observe that these two equations have one common root, that's a, right? Now if I multiply this, I'll be getting x square minus ax minus bx plus ab is equal to 0. And this is x square minus ax minus cx plus ac is equal to 0, right? Now, if I deduct this equation from this, what happens? Let's see. So that's this ax minus ax is cancelled. Then I can take x as common. Then it will be c minus b. Here I can take minus a as common. So here I'll be getting c minus b is equal to 0. That means x minus a and c minus b is equal to 0. That means x is equal to a or c is equal to b, right? But c cannot be equal to b because we have taken two different roots, right, for this equation. That means x is equal to a, right? So we got what the root that was common, okay? Here x minus a and we are getting x is equal to a. That means we are getting the value of the common root. Okay. Now the same funda we are going to apply over here. If I deduct this equation from this equation, I'll be getting an expression, right, from which I can get the common root. Okay. Or we can say common root comes out as common. So let me deduct this equation from this. So x cube minus x cube is cancelled. Then 3x square minus 2x square will be x square. Then 4x minus 7x will be minus 3x. And then 5 minus 3 is 2 is equal to 0. That means the common roots will not be, but it may be, right? So it's x minus 1, x minus 2 is equal to 0. So x is equal to 1 or 2. Right? So the common roots may be 1 or 2. It is not certain. It may be. So the common roots may be 1 or 2. But if we put the value of x as 1 in this equation or maybe in this equation, we cannot get 0 because the entire expression is positive. And if we put the positive value, we cannot get 0. Similarly for 2 also, if you put x is equal to 2, you will not be able to get 0 because the entire expression is positive. That means they do not have any roots in common. Okay, if they had any roots in common, we can get it like this. Okay, so I hope you are clear. If you are not clear for the first instance, you can just take some of the examples and try to do this calculation. You can take even numerical example also. Suppose x minus 1, x minus 2 is equal to 0, and x minus 1, x minus 3 is equal to 0. So it's x square minus 3x plus 2 is equal to 0, and it is x square minus 4x plus 3 is equal to 0. If you deduct this equation from this, so you'll be getting 3x, right? So common root we get. Okay, that one was the common root between these two. Okay, the same funda we have applied over here. So just take some more examples and practice with that. And even you can take the examples for cubic equations as well. Okay. Now, next question is, what is the remainder when 4 raised to 96 is divided by 6? Now, friends, this is bit deviation from common remainder theorem. So just listen to me carefully. Since 4 and 6, both of them are having 2 as common factors. So what I do is, first of all, I convert this entire 4 raised to 96 into as 2 raised to 192. And this is what? 2 into 3, right? Or it's 2 into 2 raised to 191 by 2 into 3. Now this 2 is common, but do not cancel them. Okay. Now we just find out the remainder when 2 raised to 191 is divided by 3, right? 2 raised to 191 when divided by 3, the remainder will be obtained by this expression. Okay, so it's minus 1 raised to 191. The remainder will be, so it will be minus 1. Now remainder cannot be negative, so it will be 3 minus 1, that's 2, right? So if 2 raised to 191 is divided by 3, the remainder is 2. Okay, now we had taken this 2 as common, so with this remainder we'll be multiplying this common, that's 2 into 2, that's 4. So final remainder will be 4, right? We can prove it algebraically also. That I already have discussed in my number system session. So do revise that particular session if you are not clear for the first time. Else, the other examples can also be taken. I just take one or two more examples similarly over here. First of all, I just take a smaller example where you can just check this method. Suppose I divide 45 by 6 and try to get remainder by this method, right? And by the regular method, we already know that the remainder will be 3. So what do we get by this method? Now 45 is what? 3 into 15. And 6 is what? 3 into 2, right? I take 3 as common. If 15 is divided by 2, I'll be getting the remainder as 1. Now that 1 into this 3, the remainder will be 3. This 3 is the number that we had taken common. Okay. And by a normal method, we know that 45 is divided by 6, the remainder will be 3. Now the same funda can be applied to bigger numbers. Suppose I have, 11 raised to 22 and I have to divide it by 22. Now I have to find out the remainder in this case. So what I do is, it's 11 into 11 raised to 21 by 11 into 2, right? This 11 I take as common. Now 11 raised to 21, if it is divided by 2, since it is an odd number and odd number is divided by 2, we'll be getting the remainder as 1. Now in this case, remainder is 1. And if this 1 is multiplied by the number that had been taken as common, we'll be getting the complete remainder, that is 1 into 11. So if 11 raised to 22 is divided by 22, remainder will be 11. Okay. So, I hope you are clear. And still, if you have some confusion, just take some smaller examples and try to verify the property. And when once you are convinced enough, then you can apply the same rule or property over the bigger numbers. Okay? Now, friends, this is a problem based on logarithm. You must be knowing the basic properties of logarithm. I just solve it over here. I just first solve right hand side. So that's this particular expression, this log 0.008. This is what, 8 by 1000. So it's 1 upon 125, or I can say it's 5 raised to minus 3. So it's 5 raised to minus 3 and 5, right? So that can be written as minus 1 upon 3 log 5 to the base 5, and that's 1, right? So precisely that is 1 minus 1 upon 3, that is 2 by 3, right? So right hand side is 2 by 3. But since the left hand side is having logarithm and to the base 3, so what I do is I just write it like this. Log 3 to the base 3, so the value of this will be 1, right? So it's precisely log 3, 3 raised to 2 by 3, okay? Now on the left hand side, just solve it out. Log of 3 m raised to 1 by 3 into n cube. And this is right hand side. Now we can take anti-log of both the sides. So m raised to 1 by 3 into n raised to 3 will be 3 raised to 2 by 3, right? Now to eliminate this 1 by 3 and 2 by 3, what I do is I just cube the entire term, that is left hand side and right hand side. So if I cube this, I'll be getting m into n raised to 3, and its cube is 9 and it's 3 raised to 2, right? So it's m into n raised to 9 is equal to 3 square. Okay, that means n raised to 9 is equal to m by 9. Or I'm sorry, n raised to 9 is equal to 9 by m. Okay? But the condition is that you must be knowing the basic properties of logarithm. I hope you are clear. Now friends, let's see this very simple problem. There are 12 towns grouped into 4 zones with 3 towns per zone. It is intended to connect the towns with telephone lines such that every 2 towns are connected with the 3 direct lines if they belong to same zone, and with only 1 direct lines otherwise. How many direct telephone lines are required? So first of all, I just make the 12 towns and 3 towns per zone. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12, right? Now the towns which are in the same zone, they should be connected with 3 lines. Every 2 towns with should have 3 lines, right? So there are 3 combinations and each combination will be having 3 lines. So 9 plus 9 plus 9 plus 9, total 36 direct lines are there when the towns are in the same zone. Otherwise, there should be one single line. So with this 1, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 9, 11, 12, with this 1, 9 lines will be there. Similarly with 2, 9 lines will be there. Similarly with 3, 9 lines will be there. So plus 27. Now with 4, 6 lines will be there. With 5, 6 lines will be there. And with 6, 6 lines will be there. So further 18. Then with 7, 3 lines will be there. With 8, 3 lines. With 9, 3 lines. So it's 9. So 36 plus 27 plus 18 plus 9, that comes out to 90 lines. Okay. I hope you are clear. Though this problem is very simple, I don't have to explain, but okay. Now friends, let's discuss this problem from quadratic equation. If both A and B belong to set 1, 2, 3, 4, then the number of equations of the form AX square plus BX plus 1 is equal to 0 having real roots. Now this is pretty simple problem. Don't have to go for any sort of derivation of any relationship. Just a simple thing. If the equation is having real roots, that means B square should be equal to greater than equal to 4A. Now A is 1, 2, 3, 4 and B is 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Now if we just see by putting the value of A and B when this condition is satisfied, right? That won't take your much time, right? If B is 1, no real root can be achieved because the minimum value of A is 4, right? So it's not possible. If B is 2, A can have the just one value, that's 1. If B is 3, A can have the this is 3 square, that's 9. So A can have the value as 1 and 2. If B is 4, A can have like 4 square, that is 16. So A can have 1, 2, 3, 4, right? 4 values. So 4 plus 2, 6 and 1, 7. So there are 7 possible combinations of A and B. Keeping this condition in mind, so we'll be having 7 equations. Okay? I hope you are clear. Now friends, let's try this problem based on logarithm. Instead of solving the equation, what we do is we just try to put the values from the option. Let's see where it suits. Suppose I put x is equal to 10, then it will be log 10 to the base 10, that's 1, minus this is root 10, that will be half. Log 10 to the base 10, that's 1, is equal to log 10 to the 10 base 10, that's 1 into 2, it's 2. So left hand side is not equal to right hand side, so it's incorrect. Now suppose this is 1 by 100, or 1 by 100 can be written as 10 raised to minus 2. Now I put the same value over here. So log 10 to the base, I'm sorry, that's minus 2 log 10 to the base 10, so it's minus 2, then minus log 10. And if it comes out the square root, it will be 10 raised to minus 1. So that minus 1 into minus, that's plus 1. This is the left hand side. You must be knowing the basic properties of log friends. Then this is, here I just write 2 log 10 raised to minus 2, 10 raised to 1. So it's 2 into minus 1 by 2 log 10 to the base 10, right? So it's minus 1. So left hand side is also minus 1 and right hand side is also minus 1. So this is the correct choice. Okay, I hope you are clear. Just for this, I just write it over here. If it's log P something like this, then it will be log. Okay, this is the relationship. Okay. Now friends, let's see this problem. What is the sum of all two digit numbers that give a remainder of 3 when they are divided by 7? The smallest of this such series will be 10, right? So 10 is 10 gives remainder as 3 when it is divided by 7. And the last number will be, that is multiple of 7 is 91, and 91 plus 3, that's 94, right? So 94 will give as remainder 3 when it is divided by 7, right? So we have to add all the numbers, and definitely this is a sequence that is in arithmetic progression, and the difference between two consecutive terms will be obviously 7, right? So first of all, let's find out how many terms are there, or how many numbers are there in the sequence. So how do we find that? So L is equal to A plus N minus 1 D. Right, this is the formula to find out the, or it gives the relationship between, among like first term, last term, common difference and number of terms, right? So last term we know, that's 94, first term is 10, and we have to find out, and D is 7, that's common difference. So 94 minus 10, that is 84, 84 divided by 7 is 12, so N is equal to 13. So in all there are 13 numbers. Now what is the sum of an arithmetic expression? That is N by 2 A plus L, right? So it's 13 by 2 into first term plus last term. So 94 plus 10, that is 104, right? Okay, so this is the correct choice. I hope you are clear. Now friends, let's see this problem further. It's based on logarithm. And in this case, we have to find out the sum of n terms. So whenever you have to find out the sum of n terms, you choose the comfortable value of n and or variables. So the problem will be simpler for us, right? Now, in this case, just be careful that do not choose the value of any variable as 1, because log 1 is 0. So you won't be able to arrive at the correct answer, right? So what I do is I choose m as 2 and n as 2, right? Right, that means m is equal to 2, n is equal to 2, and we have to find out the sum of two terms, that is these two terms only. So this, that's log 2 plus log of 4 by 2, that's log 2. So that's 2 log 2, or we can say log 4, right? So when m is equal to 2, n is equal to 2, we should get log 4. Now in which of the option by putting m and n as 2, we get log 4, we just have to see, right? So that means precisely log is everywhere, but the inside value should be 4, right? Suppose this, if it is 4, then it would be the correct choice. So if n is equal to 2, this is what? 2 by, this is 2 by, this is 2 cube. So that is 1 by 4 and what we want is log 4. So this is not correct. Instead, we should be getting 4. That means I should look for the reverse of that. So probably this may be the correct choice. So that's m raised to n plus 1. That's 2 raised to cube by 2. That's 8 by 2. That's log 4. So this will be the correct choice, right? Because 2 and 2, it's cancelled over here. So it will be just giving 1. So in this case, we are getting log 4. And to be more accurate, let's put it over here also. It's 2 raised to 2 to 2 raised to 2. It will be just 1. That's log 1 is 0. In this case, that's m 1 minus, no, here also will be getting just 1. Okay. So simply we have done this problem. So just take the comfortable value of the variable and practice with that. Okay. I hope you are clear. Now further, we have an interesting sum. Let S1 be a square of side A. Another square S2 is formed by joining the midpoints of side S1. The same process is applied to S2 and the series is going on. A1, A2, A3 be the areas and P1, P2, P3 be the perimeters, then the ratio equals. Now friends, what I do is I just draw a two-step diagram over here. Just wait a moment. Now friends, this is just a rough figure for idea. Here we see a square and the another square is formed by joining the midpoints of the outer square. Now suppose the length of the outer side is A, right? That means area of this outer square is A square, right? So we have to sum up all the areas. So the first area is A square. Then we have to proceed further. Now for this, this angle is 90 degree. This length, the length from here to here will be A by 2. And this is also A by 2, right? So we can calculate the diagonal the length of hypotenuse for this triangles. So this hypotenuse will be nothing but the side of this inside square, right? So this is something like this. So this is A by 2, this is A by 2. So that's A square by 4 plus A square by 4. That's A square by 2, right? So that's A by root 2, right? So this is the side of this square. So the area of this square will be A square by 2. Now similarly, the area of the inner square will be A square by 4, then A square by 8, and so on, right? So this is sum of all the areas. Now we know that they are forming a geometric progression, or this is an infinite geometric progression. So what is the sum of a geometric progression? That is first term divided by 1 minus common ratio. So I just take A square as common. It will be 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 4. The series is going till infinity. So it's A square 1 upon 1 minus common ratio. And what is the common ratio? That's half. So 1 upon 1 minus half. So that is 1 by 2. So it's 2. So it's 2A square. That is the sum of all the areas. Now we have to find out sum of all the perimeters. So the perimeter of this outer square is 4a, right? And the perimeter of inner square will be what? The side we calculated, that was a by root 2. So the perimeter will be 4 times a by root 2. Then the side of the third square is a by 2. So perimeter will be 4 a by 2 and so on. So we have to sum up all these perimeters. This is also an infinite geometric progression. So let's find out the sum. I can take a 4a as common. So I'll be getting 1 plus 1 upon root 2 plus 1 upon 2 and so on, right? So it's 4a into 1 upon 1 minus 1 upon root 2, or I can say it's root 2 minus 1, and here it is root 2. So this is what? Sum of all the perimeters. Here sum of all the areas, right? Now we just have to find out the ratio. Just do it over here. So that's 4a root 2 over root 2 minus 1 by 2a square by 1, right? Now we just have to simplify that to arrive at the correct answer. So it's 4 root 2a by this is root 2 minus 1 and this is 2a square, right? So this is cancelled. This is 2. So this is 2 root 2 by a into root 2 minus 1. Now we have to eliminate this thirds from the denominators. What I do is I multiply root 2 plus 1 and root 2 plus 1, right? So this is like 2 minus 1, 1. Now this is what? 2 root 2 into root 2. That's, if I take 2 as common, so it will be 2 plus root 2, right? So that's 2 into 2 plus root 2 by A, option C. Okay, the problem is a bit lengthy but not difficult at all. Okay, you just have to be clear about the infinite geometric progression. Okay, now we have this question once again from arithmetic progression and geometric progression. If three positive real numbers X, Y, Z satisfy this, then what is the minimum possible value of Y? Now friends, we know that arithmetic mean of two numbers is always greater than their geometric mean, or I can say greater than equal to, right? This is very important property, right? And good number of questions are asked on this property every year. Okay, so just mind that arithmetic mean is always greater than equal to their geometric mean. Now here we see this relationship, this and this. Here we can see that x plus z by 2 is equal to y, right? And from here I can say that x, z is equal to 4 by y. Now if I take arithmetic mean of x and z, it will be x plus z by 2. And that should be greater than equal to their geometric mean. So what is the geometric mean of x and z? That's root x z. Now x plus z by 2 is nothing but y. So y should be greater than equal to root x z. And x z is what? 4 by y. Now since all of them are positive real numbers, I can directly square them, or I can directly square this expression. So y square is greater than equal to 4 by y. That means y cube is greater than equal to 4, or I can say y cube is greater than equal to 2 square, or y is greater than equal to 2 raised to 2 by 3. That means y will the least value of y will be 2 raised to 2 by 3, right? So that's this. Okay, so we got this expression using this property, that is arithmetic mean is always greater than equal to geometric mean of any two or maybe any number of numbers, right? I hope you are clear. Friends, we'll be doing more problems of CAT 2003 in our next session. Do revise this session and I'll see you in the next session once again. Bye bye.